All right, hello anatomy friends. We have come to one of the most terror-producing parts of anatomy. But really, I think that once we kind of break down some of this and go through why we know certain things are parts of the brachial plexus, I think you'll feel a lot more comfortable regarding this. I do know that in one of Dr. Gelb's sessions, he kind of goes through a kind of stick figure way to draw out the brachial plexus, and I think that is an amazing way to go about it when you are learning the basics. And we can apply that knowledge to the actual structures of the brachial plexus to be able to identify in terms of in a practical setting. So when you're looking at something like this, it can seem a little intimidating in terms of how am I ever going to be able to tell which things are which in the parts of the brachial plexus. So we'll spend time kind of figuring out how you know you're looking at roots and trunks in this area. Then we're getting into divisions here, cords, and then of course some of the terminal branches, the marmu in terms of the five terminal branches, and then some other branches that you can see coming off of the brachial plexus a bit more proximally. So we'll, like I said, we'll review once again in terms of how you're going to be able to identify these certain structures. But if you see that on the list of structures for the practical, the majority of the focus is going to be on these terminal branches. But I do want to at least introduce some of these more proximal portions of the brachial plexus so we can kind of build our knowledge from there. And then you can focus your identification in terms of some of the terminal branches or the nerve branches coming off. All right, so let us start very proximally with the proximalmost portion of the brachial plexus. And these are, of course, the roots of the brachial plexus. As we recall, these are going to be those ventral primary rami of C5 through T1. And don't forget, we're talking ventral primary rami. These are not dorsal primary rami. So if you're looking here, just to kind of get our bearings as to what we can see, hopefully you recall the common carotid and your subclavian right here, arteries. And you can see the roots in this region here. You can see the middle scalene, the anterior scalene has been removed in order to better view these. And you can see here C5. I'm just going to write the numbers, 6, 7, 8, and then T1. And of course, all these up here are Cs or cervical. So C5, C6, C7, C8, and T1. Now, if you recall that some of these roots are going to combine their fibers to form trunks, which if we're moving down in terms of our mnemonic, this is going to be the Randy Travis. Randy is roots, Travis is going to be the trunks. And so you can see here that C5 and C6 are coming together to form the superior trunk, also referred to as the upper trunk. Same thing. So C5 and C6 come together to form this trunk, and you can see that pretty well in this particular image. C7 will continue on as the middle trunk, so we don't have the combination of the two roots for the middle trunk. And then C8 and T1 will form the inferior trunk or the lower trunk. You can see those nicely kind of coming together here to form the inferior trunk. And what you can see also is if you're looking at the subclavian artery, you see this fairly prominent branch, and this is that dorsal scapular artery that's heading towards the posterior scapula. It will run between the superior trunk and the middle trunk, and that's a fairly distinct anatomical relationship right there. So that's always running in that region. Now we're going back to, or we're going to this image that's a little bit bigger picture or bigger scale. I do want to note on this, if you're trying to get your bearings in terms of the roots, you can see C5 C6, 7, 8, and you cannot see T1 in this particular image right here. So be aware that you cannot see the T1 root, but of course it's there, and of course it's helping to form that. It's just deep to the muscles right here. The muscle was kept in this particular donor, in this particular dissection. So you can see how they're combining C5 and C6 to the superior trunk. C7 is that continuation. You would see T1 and C8 coming together to form this inferior trunk here. And then once we get past the trunks, each trunk is going to be divided into these anterior and posterior divisions. You do not need to ID the divisions because honestly, there's some variation here and it's difficult. This is where a lot of that combination of fibers is occurring. But in some areas, I do find it useful to locate these, particularly in terms of the posterior divisions. You can see all three of these coming together to help form this posterior cord. So I do like to try to locate that one. Anterior divisions are a little bit more difficult to identify. But just keep in mind that we're going from those roots to the trunks, to the divisions of the anterior and posterior divisions, and then we get to the cords. So let's talk about each one of those. As mentioned in the active learning session and in other areas, the names of these cords are based on the relative position to the axillary artery, specifically the second part, when an individual is in an anatomical position. But usually, in order to see all parts of the brachial plexus, particularly in a dissection or in other areas, the upper limb will need to be a little bit abducted or abducted, so not quite in anatomical position. So often the lateral cord is going to look more superior, and the medial cord will look more inferior than, say, medial or lateral. But that is why they are named that way. Okay, so let's get our bearings in terms of these cords. I always look at the posterior, just like I said, because I find that one the easiest to be able to identify because I can see all those posterior divisions coming together. So this is the posterior cord. The medial cord is going to be the anterior division of that inferior trunk, and so here's that inferior trunk up here. So this is going to be the medial cord. And then the lateral cord, it's going to be the anterior divisions, which you can see those two coming together there, of the superior and middle trunks. So this is going to be that lateral cord. All right. You can see in terms of that medial and the lateral cord that there's going to be contributions of those cords heading to the median nerve. So that looks, there'll be kind of an extension of those cords as they reach to the median nerve. But for the most part, they're going to be right around this region and this axillary region. Okay, so let's talk about some of the named branches, and then we'll spend some time on the terminal branches. There's going to be two named branches that are not those terminal branches of the brachial plexus that we want you to know. One is going to be the suprascapular, which we'll talk about right now. The second will be the thoracodorsal, which we'll talk about in a moment. So suprascapular nerve is going to be a direct branch of the superior trunk. So before I do it, I want you to look at this image and try to identify yourself on your own where the superior trunk is. Okay, so here are some clues. If this is C5, and this is C6, we know that those two roots come together to form the superior trunk. So you're looking at this, and you're seeing that there's not really a branch on this particular dissection coming off of the superior trunk, and that's true. You can see it a little bit right here. Do you see that? So that, and I'm going to make this go away and come back so it's clean right here. So you can see at that superior trunk right there, a small branch coming directly off the superior trunk. You can see it's heading directly towards the scapular region, because recall that the suprascapular is going to innervate your supra and your infraspinati muscles on the posterior scapula. So you can see it heading in that direction. So if you see a branch coming directly off the superior trunk, you are looking at the suprascapular nerve. Now, talking about the ulnar nerve, and I do have these images up here that are color-coded. I do think it will help in terms of the discussion. You are more than free to kind of look at it without this as well. There are going to be BlueLink images that have it without this as well, but for the purposes of this session, we are going to kind of work through this here. So, the ulnar nerve is going to be the terminal branch of your medial cord. So here's your medial cord, and you can see it looks like almost just a continuation of that medial cord. The dominant roots nerve fibers are coming from C8 and T1, and in a lot of resources you will only see C8 and T1 for the ulnar nerve. More recent literature is really kind of honing in on the fact that there is often some contributions from the lateral cord in terms of from C7, and that's what you can see and why we have this highlighted here. But really we're going to focus mainly on the traditional, and so you'll see this I think in Dr. Gelb's sessions as well, C8 and T1. We won't test on any of these discrepancies that there are between the two sources, but you can really see how it looks like a continuation of the medial cord here, and then occasionally there's some contributions from C7 and the lateral cord. But really we want to focus on the fact that it's mainly coming from the medial cord, as you can see here. Okay, next we have musculocutaneous. And musculocutaneous is going to be a terminal branch of the lateral cord. And you can see over here is that lateral cord right here. And then you can see this continuation of a nerve branch that looks like it's heading towards that coracobrachialis in the anterior compartment of the arm. And that is going to be a very characteristic way to identify musculocutaneous in the anterior arm as it pierces through coracobrachialis. Musculocutaneous is dominantly derived from C5 and C6. It can have contributions from C7, but we will focus more on the C5 and C6 contributions. And you can see that it looks pretty clear, like it's coming directly as a continuation from the lateral cord. Okay, median nerve, one of my favorite ones, and the reason it's one of my favorite ones is because it's a little bit easier to identify. You can kind of pick up all the terminal branches, and it almost looks like a nice M. And really, this portion, the middle portion of the M, is going to be the median nerve. It is going to receive contributions from two different cords. All the rest are predominantly from one, with perhaps smaller contributions, but these are fairly large contributions from both the medial and the lateral cords. And then once they kind of combine together, these contributions, then you call the nerve at that point the median nerve. And like I said, this is where you're getting that middle portion of the M. You can see kind of that M right here. And so that's that continuation there as it heads to innervate predominantly that anterior forearm region. Okay, now let's talk about some branches of the posterior cord. When you're talking about terminal branches from the posterior cord, the main ones that come up are the axillary and, of course, the radial nerve. But you can see that there is going to be an additional branch, which is your thoracodorsal. So let's return. I want you to take a moment to see if you can identify the posterior cord here before I kind of point out some of the hints to get to it. So try to find the posterior cord. Okay, so if you are feeling a little lost, perhaps I can help out. So you can see these posterior divisions from the trunks coming together to form this posterior cord here. So right here where I'm kind of highlighting. This is going to be the posterior cord, and you are going to have a small branch that will come off of the posterior cord that's not axillary and that's not radial, and this is the thoracodorsal, which you can see right here. thoracodorsal is going to innervate your latissimus dorsi, and you can see that it's heading towards the region where the latissimus dorsi would be located. So it's heading in kind of inferiorly to head to that fairly large muscle belly that's associated with the latissimus dorsi. Okay, the other two, or the last two terminal branches, and these are both coming from the posterior cord. The first that we're going to discuss is your axillary, which you can see here shaded in pink. And it is going to be the smaller of the terminal branches of the posterior cord. Radial nerve is by far larger. You can see it's also heading towards the humerus, specifically that surgical neck of the humerus, which it will wrap around the posterior portion on its way to innervate the deltoid muscle and the infraspinatus. Lastly is the radial nerve. And the radial nerve, I feel, is one of the easier ones to identify as well, just due to its size. It's going to be slightly larger than even the median nerve, typically. It is very posteriorly placed. And as I mentioned, it's quite large. It's typically the largest in terms of diameter of the terminal branches of the brachial plexus, which makes sense because you have all these posterior divisions coming together to form the posterior cord. And so you have these posterior divisions, then here is the cord here, and then what just looks like a continuation, kind of once it gives off the axillary right here, it kind of divides into axillary, and then the name changes to radial. From this region, and of course heading towards the posterior compartments of both the arm and the forearm. So those are the things that we are going to have you identify in terms of the brachial plexus. While you don't have to memorize specifically some of the how to identify some of the roots and the trunks, it is helpful in terms of being able to identify some of the more distal branches or the terminal branches of the brachial plexus. All right, I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day. As always, please feel free to reach out to myself or any of the anatomy faculty. As you would imagine, brachial plexus is one of our favorite areas. Thanks and have a good day.